Happy Mother's Day if somebody hasn't mentioned it to you. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Woman's Day. Please, we're going to invite you to stand. And if you can, sing with us. If you know some of these songs, great. We're going to open up with an opener that's more energetic this morning. But it's just a praise of celebration today. Amen? Amen. Here we go. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King, for His love endures forever. For He is good, He is above all things, and His love endures forever. Sing praise with a mighty hand, and with a mighty hand, and outstretched arm. Promise of the Lord, He's with us forever. This is the day that You have made. Whatever comes, I won't complain. For all my hope is in Your name, and now Your joy. Oh, it's my praise. Give thanks for all You have done, and I will sing of Your mercy and Your love. Your love is unfailing, Lord, I am grateful. When I was down, You brought me out and set my feet on higher ground. So here I stand, You are my God, Your faithfulness my solid rock. I give thanks for all You have done, and I will sing of Your mercy and Your love. Your love is an Lord, I am grateful.
we lift our hands, the heavens open, heavens open. So let our lives declare the love our God has spoken over us. And as we lift our hands, the heavens open, heavens open. So
those songs are so fast. It's insane. But it's so good because he is faithful. You know, if you're going through something today or yesterday or the day before or this last year, that's our hope, right? That God is faithful. We lean on him. We trust in him because he loves us so, so much. The song's Goodness of God.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness.
Me. Your goodness is running out.
Father God, we honor you today. We look to you first. I know it's a holiday. And we came all dressed up, some of us. And we honor our moms and the beautiful women that are around us and the joy that they bring to our lives. But we come to you first. We enter this place and we say, we love you, Father. We love you, Jesus. We love you, God. We do not deserve your love, but you give it anyway. We trust you because of those things. Guide us in our life. Show us the way. Help us to lean on you. We pray. We love you, Jesus. And everybody said, amen.
A Mother's Love by Helen Steiner Rice. A mother's love is something that none can explain. It is made of deep devotion and of sacrifice and pain. It is endless and unselfish and enduring come what may, for nothing can destroy it or take that love away. It is patient and forgiving when all others are forsaking, and it never fails or falters even though the heart is breaking. It believes beyond believing when the world around condemns, and it glows with all the beauty of the brightest, rarest gems. It is far beyond defining, it defies all explanation, and it still remains a secret like the mysteries of creation. A many-splendored miracle man cannot understand, and another wondrous evidence of God's tender guiding hand.
Thank you, Sophia. So, at this point, happy Mother's Day. Kids are now dismissed, and would you guys just take a couple minutes to stand up, wander around, and greet everyone around you. Introduce yourself to someone you don't know.
I have the privilege of welcoming you all here this morning on this Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to all of you. And I know Mother's Day is such a celebratory day for some people, and it's such a sad day for others. So wherever you are at, we are so grateful to have you here on this day together with us. So a few announcements here. If you have not filled out a welcome card before, we would love to get connected with you. You will see in the back of the chairs. There are some welcome cards. Fill that out and bring it to the Welcome Center. There is a gift awaiting you and a lovely person or two to talk with you and just let you know more about Grace and get connected with you. So then I would like to invite Martha for a couple announcements.
Good morning. Happy Mother's Day. We have a job opportunity for some of you. Wanted to let you know about. There is our camp that we attended women's retreat at down in the Santa Cruz Mountains, Redwood Christian Park, is looking for people for their summer staff. And so if you are interested in that, you can see me after church. I'll be out at the welcome counter. But you get free room and your meals from July 11th through July 30th. And there's all kinds of opportunities for culinary, children's ministry, youth ministry, recreational ministry, programming, maintenance, music and worship, housekeeping, all of those things. So, and they pay you weekly as well. I think it's around $300-$325 a week, plus your room and board. So please see me about that. If you know anyone that's college age, 18 to older, could be older for sure. Okay. So the other thing I want to let you ladies know about is this coming Saturday, we have our Spring Bling right here. And we are so excited. We want to let you know that you don't have to bring bling to participate. We want you to come and fellowship. It's going to be really a great time of fellowship. But we are also going to be learning about a beekeeper and how that correlates with God's word, scripture in the Bible, and the intricacies of how the hive works together, all the parts that the bees do to make honey is incredible. So we are so excited for that. So we want you to come and be a part of that. But like I said, you don't have to bring bling to come. Also, you can bring bling and not take bling home. So if you have bling that you want to get rid of, so we're talking hats, scarves, jewelry, purses. What else, ladies? Are we thinking belts? Thank you. Anyway, gently used. Come and be a part. It's really going to be a lot of fun. And we need. We ask you bring a snack to share, but we will have breakfast here in the morning. It's more than continental. We will have protein. So, ladies, come ready to eat, and we're going to have a lot of fun together. Thank you.
Thank you, Martha. Sounds awesome. Any bling anyone wants to trade in, that's the time. So next announcement, we're moving right to the men here. So we have a trap shoot and dinner Saturday, May 20th, 5 to 9, and it's $10 a ticket. Today is the last day to sign up. So if you haven't signed up yet, look for some male walking around with a red clipboard after church. Oh, I see a red clipboard back there. Mel, you want to... Mel's got one. So if you see a red clipboard like that, that's what you're looking for after church. Oh, look at all these. So look for one of these men that are connected to a red clipboard and sign up, and they'll be wandering around the church center afterwards. So, and then last here, we have three ways to give here at Grace. we have, they're all up here, but we've got the Venko app, we've got the back box in the back, and we have, you can mail in. So you've got three different ways, and we just want to thank you for continuing to give to help keep ministries like our women's ministry and men's ministry and things going here at Grace. So let's just go to the Lord together. Lord, thank you for this sunny day and just your presence with us here, Lord. Just have great anticipation of what you have for each of us here in this service, Lord. May our hearts just be just calmed and open to what you have, Lord, for us today. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen.
Our youth girls, we would love for you to come. So I forgot to mention that you are all invited. Thank you.
Very good. I was going to say if there's protein, I'll be there. But it's Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day, everybody. And, you know, we are aware that sometimes it's difficult to have a Mother's Day. Maybe your mother has passed on, or maybe your mom's got some ailments or trouble, or maybe, you know, maybe you've lost children or have wayward children, or there's so many pressures that are on moms. But we are very, very thankful for the beauty that they just present in our lives and represent, and really all women are that way. So we thank you for that. I remember when I was a child that I had a bunk bed that I would sleep on. And my mother, she would always she did everything for me. It was really horrible. she would make the bed. She would clean the room. And occasionally she'd make me do it. And I wouldn't want to do it. I just didn't want to do it. I was too lazy. She really came alongside and she would make it happen. But I remember there were a few times sitting up on that bed where I had trouble, as children do, as you're a young boy, as you're a young man growing up. And I felt things a lot more strong than I do today. I was a much more emotional kid. And I remember several nights just kind of crying myself to sleep and, you know, praying for my mom to come and help and just be there for me. But on the days that maybe I was just too far gone to call for her, and in my tears, in my bunk bed, top bunk, I remember, you know, my faith taking hold of me. And I remember that I would just pray to God. And I just say, hey, you know, I need you right now. I need your help. I need something. I got something going on in my life, and I really need you right now. And as the night would progress, and the tears would get worse and thicker and heavier, and I'd be so tired, laying out and just waiting to try to go to sleep somehow. And my mom wasn't there, so I would take my hand and I'd physically just reach up, as if knowing that God would actually be there to take my hand. And I pictured him not grabbing it like this, grabbing it more like this, just holding on to me, letting me know that it's okay, I've got you. I've got you, no matter what you're going through. And I take that today. I still feel that way today. Anytime I'm going through something, my hand goes up physically. There might not be anything there. It might just be air. But I know that my God has me. And if that's you today, reach up. Reach up. He'll take you every time. Every time. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, precious Lord, lead me home. When my way grows dreary, precious Lord, make a day. When my life is on, precious Lord, lead me home. When the darkness appears and the night draws near and the day is past and gone, precious Lord, lead me home. Shake my hand. Shake my hand. Precious Lord, lead me home. Through the storm, through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. That's our prayer. Amen? Amen. Let's go ahead and stand for our reading of the word this morning.
Good morning. Today we'll be in 1 Peter 2:11 through 17. Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. Honor everyone, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the emperor. Thank you. You may be seated.
Thank you, Patrick. Good morning, everyone. Welcome this morning. I want to make a couple observations as we begin this morning, particularly about yesterday. So many of you were at Dennis Voigt's Celebration of Life yesterday. Nancy and Dennis have long been members of Grace and great contributors to the building up of the body of Christ, our church family here. And as you, many of you know, Dennis had early onset Alzheimer's and went to be with the Lord a number of weeks ago. We had his Celebration of Life yesterday. That's what these flowers are here for. They looked a lot happier yesterday. They're a little thirsty today. But they represent the love that was poured out toward the Voigt family. And so we're really grateful. And I just, it's one of the things that, if I could say it this way, I love about a Celebration of Life or a memorial service is that you get to know the measure of a human being in that service. People point to the things that were meaningful to them about the value of that person's life. And if you know Dennis, and if you were here yesterday, you heard some profound statements of genuine value that though Dennis was a quiet, more reserved person, he profoundly impacted the lives of the people around him, most notably his family, those he worked with and for, and the close friends around him. And it just spoke so meaningfully to me that coming away from a service like that of someone who lived life well with purpose for the sake of the Lord, even though their life maybe wasn't lived out in front of people and influencing big groups, we tend to gravitate maybe sometimes toward those people. I walked away from that service feeling like, I just want to love Jesus more. I want to love Jesus more. It was an inspiring day for me. And so we remember the Voigt family today and grateful for Dennis's life. I also want to just put as a little sidebar, I get so excited about when God's community of faith, God's family here at Grace works together. You guys work together in an amazing way to pull off things like yesterday's service. We had, you know, we had our room set up just like you see it today. And for the lunch that immediately followed the service, we needed this many chairs to, you know, house a 300 plus group of people coming to the service. We had to transform the whole thing and set up tables with tablecloths, with centerpiece flowers and things, transform the whole thing to a lunch. And that idea was met with a little bit of skepticism. Some people were like, what are you going to do? I just want to note it. Then when we excused people out of this space, we're going to transform it. We transformed this place from, as you see it, to tables with centerpieces, tablecloths, and invite people to sit down in 12 minutes. 12 minutes. That is you guys working together in an amazing way. So I was pretty impressed by that. I just want to say I'm pretty impressed. So thank you. So this morning, as we turn to our text, I'm just so grateful for the writing of Peter, who is so identifiable, so relatable. Now, you think about Peter. He was not from a prestigious school. He was not a great influencer in his community and so on. He was a fisherman, you'll remember. And among all of many of the disciples were fishermen. Not all of them, obviously, but he was an everyday guy. But he had a personality about him that just, he was pretty passionate as a person. And when Jesus called Peter to follow him, and Peter said yes, he was all in even to the point of his own, you know, overstating and overstepping some boundaries that Jesus kind of had to put him in his place sometimes. You know, the very same conversation with someone like Peter, Jesus could have an interaction with him in one moment he's saying, you know, you are saying things that God alone has revealed to you. And in just one sentence later, get behind me, Satan. Where is that coming from? You know, same conversation, same context with this guy. This guy was passionate and just so wanted to please God and serve him, but he was a kind of a rough guy and so on. I love how those elements come out in Peter's life. You see Peter through the words of this letter in his heart in a way that this is an individual whom God has transformed. God has taken a heart full of maybe some ambition with his business. He was a successful businessman as a fisherman. His heart of pride at times. You see some of that in his interactions with Jesus. His refusal to allow Jesus to wash his feet. Jesus said, no, you got to be humble. You need humility for me to do this. And so he submitted to that. You see this passionate person whom God infused with his own Holy Spirit, this work of transformation in his life. And it is Peter who writes this letter, and he writes things that are so reflective of his interactions with Jesus. I love it. If we were to take the letter of Peter and just bring out statements that he says that could be directly and indirectly connected to statements Jesus has made, that would be a very fun study. We're going to do a little bit about that this morning, but it's an amazing letter. I really enjoy this. And the message of Peter, as he writes this letter, he's writing to a group of people whom he calls exiles. He says, I'm writing you from Babylon. Now, this all becomes figurative language to denote the fact that this world isn't our home. These words are meant to say that we are a people of value, a people within a particular community, but we don't quite fit in to the greater structures of the society around us. In fact, the people around us look at us with suspicion. They call us evildoers. They malign us at times. And we'll understand about that more as we read the letter continually. But he raises their status as reflective of the reality of how God sees them, because he himself received the same kind of elevation of his own life. I'm just an ordinary guy, he would say, but God sees in me value, and he has elevated me to a task, and I'm going to do that with all that task with all my heart. I'm going to do it with passion. And that's what comes out and reflected in his writing. So today, he's going to tackle a subject matter that really is at the heart of this message. We've spent every week until now laying the foundation of his message, that is, identifying who they are as a people and raising their status in God's eyes, though the society around them has considered them as exiles, as sojourners, as people that don't quite fit in, marginal people. And he said, no, you're valuable people and you have a purpose. Now he's going to attach that value and purpose to how do we live out our faith in the world. And he says today he's going to make the argument we need to live as people as honor. He's going to connect this to the theme of the book, which is how is a Christian to relate to the society in which we live, particularly when our values that we uphold don't match the values of our culture or the values of the society around us. They're at odds at some level, and it creates friction, creates conflict. How do we conduct our lives? And he does that a number of ways, one of which we've already talked about, that he says, your kingdom is not of this world, that we follow a king who is going to return and rescue us. He's going to set up a kingdom in the future that we'll all be citizens of and function in the way that God intends. But for now, we do live in a foreign land, a land that doesn't align with the values of God, who's going to fulfill his purpose in his kingdom eventually. So there's a now and a then part of the message. So how do we live now, in the now part? How do we relate to the society around us when we have values that are more associated with a kingdom not of this world? God's values that are always agreed upon here. And so he writes in chapter 2, he says this. This is how we are to live. He says, keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of his visitation. So, why is Peter saying that these people around you, society around you, calling you evildoers? Why would anybody call Christians evildoers? We're the most loving, humble, meek people ever, if we're living out the values of God. However, that's not always the case, right? We're not always living in accord with that. Sometimes the circumstance and so on causes us to say things and do things that might not be all that well received in the world and the culture around us. How do we live this? How do we live honorable? Well, partly it's we have to understand why on earth these people that Peter is writing to, why would they be called evildoers according to the people that live around them and they live with in the same households in many cases that Peter will point out? Why would they call them evildoers? And later on, Patrick already had read another part of us, part of this passage for us in verse 15. He says, for this is the will of God, that by doing good you will put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. So people are talking about this faith community. They're talking about Christians. They're calling them evildoers. And he'll say in other ways how we've been marginalized as Christians by the culture around us. Why on earth would they be called evildoers? And here's the root of it. Here's the heart of it. It's because there are differences in cultural values. When one subpart of a culture holds cultural values that are different than the culture around them, they'll immediately be put into a category as suspect. I'm not sure if I can trust you, because we all agree as a culture, as a society, on a certain set of principles and values that we all live by, and you're doing something different. And different all the time is going to put somebody in a marginalized position. We all learned this in junior high, did we not? If we feel a little different, we are always going to be, we're going to feel that difference because we have a sense of belonging. I want to fit in. And if you're like me, I'm a peacemaker at heart. And also a part of my personality, particularly growing up, that age and maturity you have to temper if you're going to live an authentic life, is that I so desperately wanted to fit in that I would kind of take on the persona or things that I thought was what people wanted from me. So as a shy, introverted person, little kid, I found, okay, and I wasn't the best student. Maybe that was how some students I saw fit in. They were like really good students. Oh, that is value. But I wasn't that. I was a C/B student, ADD, ADHD. I was not good at study, even through college. It wasn't until later in my adult life that I figured out how to study. Not only that, I wasn't a great athlete. I loved sports. I loved competition. But the body that I was given, though athletic, wasn't as athletic as my peers. If I wanted to play football, because you were cool if you played football, being 5'1", 100 pounds, soaking wet, didn't make you a really great football player. And that's what I was. So I thought, oh, well, I'm going to excel in wrestling, right? Because you're only wrestling people the same size. And I found that, you know, size is really not even the same equator, because you're going to wrestle someone who's just more athletic. I was athletic, but not I didn't win a lot. That was so discouraging as a young person, trying to find where do I fit in? Where do I belong? Where is my value? And so me, as a little kid, you take on different personas. You try them on for size. What gets me to fit in? So I turned to being a jokester. I would disrupt class. I would try to make people laugh. We had Jackson Cinemas was built when I was in junior high, in my early years of high school here. I grew up here in Amador County. And so, you know, prior to you, everybody's there. They're a confined audience waiting for the movie to start. Me and my friends, we'd often take that as opportunities to do stand-up comedy in the front of the theater. We go up there and we tell jokes, we do sketches, we act out things and try to get people to laugh. I figured this is the way. And then, you know, I thought about music. Music is the way I'm going to make my mark, and so on. And just we all know where I'm going to fit in, what is my value, where is my belonging. And then we have to, as we grow in maturity and as an adult, we learn to differentiate that I have to figure out who I am, and my value doesn't always come from someone else's observation. And so I have to say, it's okay if my opinion doesn't match your opinion. It's okay if my values don't match your values. I can live at peace with myself knowing that you don't agree with me and you may not even like me as a result. I've got to come to peace with that. We do that as mature adults. This is the message Peter's trying to send them. It's okay that you don't have the same values, but as a culture, we generally don't like that. It puts us at odds. It gives a conflict. We want to fit in. We have to be able to fight against this desire to fit in. And so this manifests with this people of God that Peter is writing. And you'll see some relatability even in our own experiences I've already alluded to. Number one, they believed that there was just one God who created all things, who governs all things, who sustains all things, who owes our devotion and our worship, one God. This made them stand out from everybody else because everybody else, particularly in the Roman Empire, believed that there were many gods. What do you mean there's not many gods? What do you mean that we shouldn't be offering a sacrifice and thanks to the God who might bring rain to our crops? No, we don't got to bring sacrifices to him or her. We bring it to the one true God. Well, I don't have children and I got to make the right sacrifices so I could have a child. No, we don't make sacrifices to that God. We just have the one God. Well, I want my business to flourish. I got to make a sacrifice to that God. You see how it goes? And that was just a normative part of the culture in Rome in the first century. That's how you did things. And so the Christians were saying, those gods aren't real. They don't even exist. They're not true gods. There's only one God. This caused Christians to be known as atheists. This idea, the word we use today, atheists, were first attributed to Christians because Christians didn't believe in the gods. They're atheists. Now, we use that, obviously, for someone who doesn't believe in any God. But they were different. They stood out. And the people, when everybody believes a certain thing is true, and you're the only one as a community who doesn't believe that one thing, there's going to be suspicion. You're disrupting the very core and fabric of our culture, our society. I'm not sure if I should trust you. I don't know if you're wanting good for us. Suspicion is at the very least how they're being considered. Think about this. Christians believe that Jesus is king. There's only one person I serve. I emulate my life after. That is God's son, Jesus Christ. And one day he's going to return. He's going to set up his kingdom on earth. And we will all follow him as our one true king, sitting on David's throne. Now, this message follows in direct conflict with Rome and what they believed, that Caesar is king. In fact, you'll remember when Jesus was crucified, the Jews could not bring a charge against Jesus that would stick because Jesus was an innocent man. Even the stories they made up to try to malign him, they couldn't agree on how to make, there was just no evidence against him. And went to Rome to try to get Rome to do something about him. Rome found no evidence against Jesus either. They said, you know, this seems to be something that has to do with your laws. Why are you bringing even him to us? And it had to be through manipulation and so on that finally they got Rome to act and crucify Jesus by declaring that the Jews said, they themselves said, Jesus claims to be king And to us, the Jews who were trying to get Jesus crucified, there is only one king, and that's Caesar. That was their argument. They manipulated the authorities to crucify Jesus. And when they crucified him, remember, they put a sign above his name, his head, which said, Jesus, here is Jesus, King of the Jews. And they wrote it in several different languages. This was not to honor Jesus. This was Rome sending a message. And when people were crucified, remember, they would always be crucified on very public avenues. In this case, it was outside of the city of Jerusalem, on a major thoroughfare. He was crucified with three thieves. And this is the message Rome wanted everybody to see. This is what Rome does to people who challenge our institutions, who challenge our authority. Here is one who claimed to be a king. Here's the honor Rome gives to those who claim to be a king. We crucify them publicly, naked. We shame them, and we just see exactly how much power they have. They don't. This is what Rome does. And so a believer in the first century says, Jesus is my king. That puts them in direct opposition with everybody else who says, Caesar is our king. What are you saying? That is treasonous, what you are saying. What does Rome do with treasonous activity? They execute him. Right? You're putting yourself in a position of, I don't trust you. Are you a usurper? Are you planning some sort of revolt? You could see why these people would start to say evil things or malign Christians. They just don't trust them because of their different beliefs. And finally, what we see in Peter's letter is revealed that all the Christians had this strong viewpoint that all members of the community were equally valuable. Peter has already gone to great lengths to demonstrate this in the weeks that we've studied to this point, that there is neither male nor female, Jew nor Greek, slave nor free. These are Paul's words. I'm not trying to use Paul to interpret Peter, but Peter aligns with this by saying you are co-heirs. You are not exiles and marginalized people. You are co-heirs with one another for the kingdom. You are valuable people, and you are equal to one another. Yet they were living in a culture that had very clear hierarchy of value among members of the community. It was an accepted fact that there's an aristocracy at the top. You were born into it. You don't work your way up to the top in this culture. You're born into that. You have wealth or you don't have wealth. You are free or you're a slave. If you're a slave, you're really something less than human. Your property. Even if you're somehow able to secure your freedom through work or paying off debts or whatever it is, still you're not considered a plebeian, which is your normal general crowd that made up most of Rome. You're still called a former slave or a freedman. That was your status. You never quite got to. And if you, in a Roman Empire, if you had, for instance, citizenship. I'm a Roman citizen. Paul had citizenship. That afforded you certain rights and privileges that people that didn't have Roman citizenship could not have. For instance, Paul, because he was a Roman citizen, could not be beaten in public. And when he was, at times, he said, do you know you're beating a Roman citizen? Paul, for instance, as a Roman citizen, could not be crucified. This is why it was believed that Paul, when he met his end for the gospel, he was not crucified. Tradition tells us Peter was crucified for the end of his life, as were many Christians. It wasn't just because they crucified him because they crucified Jesus. No, they crucified anybody that they wanted to make an example of who wasn't falling in line with the principles and values of Rome. But Paul couldn't be crucified because he was a Roman citizen. So tradition tells us he was beheaded. Beheading as a form of execution was the most humane, if you can call it that, way that they considered because it was a quick death, whereas crucifixion would last for days in many cases. It was excruciating, humiliating, painful death. And here is a group of Christians who uphold these values that make them different. And these different values not only marginalize them as being different, but these values make them suspicious. Are these usurpers? Are you going to plan some sort of revolt? And he's going to apply them to everyday practices like slaves. Citizens, slaves, and wives in a household. These are three areas where in that culture are expected certain rules of subjection. And Peter's going to address each one. How do we as believers function in a culture where our values are different, yet we want to appeal to our fellow citizens about who God is? We want everybody to be saved. How do we do this? How is a Christian to relate to the society in which they live? That's the message. And he's going to give very clear examples. First, as citizens, that's what we're going to study today. Next, as slaves, which obviously we don't uphold slavery. How does a slave who believes they're free with regard to kingdom values, how does a slave who believes I'm equal to my master in kingdom values live in a real world where I'm not a free man and I'm considered much less than a human being versus less, let alone equal to my master? How do I function in that space? Peter gives them some specific ideas. And then in the case of a wife, into a household in a patriarchal Roman household, the husband had complete authority, or it was called the pater familias. He was the head of the household. And a wife had the honor of and the duty of allowing that patriarchal male to have an heir. That was the primary role of the wife, and to educate those children, the legitimate children, because there were also other children of the household, that they weren't able to be heirs of that household, but they were nevertheless half-sisters, half-brothers. But there was one wife who was produced legitimate heirs to keep the household intact. These household codes of the first century is what kept the society, the fabric of society intact. So if I'm beginning to challenge some of these things as a believer, you can see how that would threaten Roman peace, Roman society, Roman way of thinking. Who are you people, and do we need to do something about you? Peter is very aware of these thoughts. He says, how do we silence the foolish talk of people who don't know better? He calls them foolish, ignorant talk. How do we silence those who would call us evildoers? We're not. How do we silence that? Here's how we do it. This is the advice he gives. Just two things. One, live honorable lives. Live lives worthy of honor so that it would silence the foolish talk. And they couldn't call us evildoers. And we're going to talk more about what that looks like. And secondly, we treat other people with honor. Even if they believe something different than us, even if they hold to values that aren't ours, we still respect them, value them, treat them with dignity and honor, because they're also what we believe as Christians, made in the image of God. They're human beings worthy of honor. They might be acting according to a different set of principles, different values that we don't agree with, but they're still people whom God loves, whom God sent Jesus to die for. And how do we get that message to them that God values you? Even though we disagree about what is good in the world, how do I communicate to you that God values you? We know this is Peter's message because he says it in verse 12, that we live honorable lives, we treat others with honor, that they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of his visitation. That is the point. How do we live in such a way so that people would see us? Not only would they not say foolish, ignorant things or malign us or call us evildoers, but we'd still be able to communicate the values of the kingdom in a way that they would in turn place their faith in Jesus, come to a saving knowledge of God, and in the end, when Jesus comes, they're going to be a part of the family of God. How do we do that? He says, the foundation of this is live honorable lives, treat others with honor. So let's look at that first one. What does Peter say in how we live honorable lives? First of all, we've already read this a couple of weeks ago, but it begins at the very first verse of this chapter. So if you have your Bibles open, look at that first passage in chapter 2 and verse 1. When Peter says, so put away, first of all, if you're going to live a life of honor, you need to put away any kind of values that would be contrary not only to the values we hold as Christians, but also to the values that the society around us doesn't hold to either. We can't be found to be actual evildoers in any way. So he says, so put away all malice, all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander. So we put these practices away. So Anybody who wants to, who's suspicious of us, they can't say, aha, uh-huh, see, right there. They're guilty. You know, that slave was guilty of thieving something in this household. Or you are guilty of maligning that person. You're slandering other people. You're no different. You actually are evildoers. And Peter says, no, we need to silence that foolish talk. And so we need to live lives of honor that put away any of these vices, these of our desires. See, what does he say here? He opens up with this. Go back to chapter 2 and verse 11, where we started. He says, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh. So we as Christians, though we hold these values, we still have this sin nature in us that wars, Peter says, against our soul. Things that we want to say and do that are contrary, but it just feels so good in the moment when somebody is saying maybe something foolish against me, and I'm like, or we have a value that is in conflict with another. I want to act toward them in my anger. I want to come up with some zinger of a argument, right, that makes you look like an idiot, you know. And we kind of enjoy watching this on YouTube channels, right, and those, you know, people who are really adept at making great arguments and so on, somebody in the, they have these open forums, they're like professionals, right? So you have somebody come to the microphone and I have this zinger for you, Mr. Commentator, and also the commentator just like makes him look like an idiot, right? We enjoy watching that stuff, like, yeah, I want to do stuff like that because it feels good in the moment. I want to give that person the zinger, see how dumb they are for holding their viewpoints. Peter's saying, don't do stuff like that. Don't do stuff that's going to put you in a position to draw away from the values of who Jesus is. How are we conducting ourselves with honor and honoring other people? So first of all, put away anything that's just going to draw attention away from the values of the kingdom, malice, deceit, hypocrisy, envy, any kind of slander. And that's just a short list. We can expand from there. First of all, make sure we're not doing things that does not align with the heart of Jesus and the kingdom. And secondly, in a positive way, we read in verse 12, do good things. Do good things. Be generous. Somebody's like, I'm not sure I trust you because we don't hold the same values. At the same time, I'm in a place of need, and you're the first one that comes to my rescue. You're doing kind things toward me, even though I'm kind of holding you at an arm's distance. Maybe I don't even know you. I was using this example as a 9 a.m. hour when I was teaching there earlier. It's like many times in my life, I have pulled over to help someone who had a flat tire. I wanted to express the love of God toward them and the kindness that God has shown me, right? I didn't deserve anything that God has given me, but yet he loves me. He's offered his son to die for me and express that love, whether I believe him in him or not. I want to express that kind of tangible love in the good deed of pulling over and helping someone change their tire, or helping someone load their groceries into their car when it's a storm, or let me grab your cart for you and I'll return it. You just get in your car. It's raining cats and dogs. You know, these random acts of kindness that we could display toward one another. And here's how I do it. I am not an evangelist by giftedness. I am not one to just, you know, wear billboards, you know, that say, you know, Jesus loves you, you know, at some highway intersection. I love those guys that are men and women who do that right there in front of Costas. You see them under the 10x10 canopy. We want to pray for you. I love that. More power to them. I just don't feel compelled me to put myself out there publicly. It's just not my personality. Yeah, I want people to know who God is. How do I do that? I do that by helping someone change a tire and say, like, why are you doing this? You're putting yourself at risk. We're on the side of a road. I say, no, you stay in the vehicle. You know, no problem. I'll do this. I know how to do it. We'll get you where you need to go. Why would you do this? Well, it's because God loves me. God loves me. I don't deserve it. I'm just trying to pass that along. That's all I'm doing. It's a simple message of kindness and connecting it somehow to God. And enough people in that person's life are doing that. It's like, why did you take my cart to the thing? Why did you help me with this? I don't even know you. Well, you know, God loves me, so I'm just passing it along. All of a sudden, that person is like, there's something to this. And I drive by this church called Grace Fellowship. I see that sign. I see the care they give to the entrance. Man, all those flowers, that looks pretty cool. That seems like a pretty cool place. Maybe I'm going to go visit there one day. The reason they might choose to drive up that driveway one day is because many of you over time have just done enough simple acts of kindness, doing good deeds in this community. Maybe you're not the evangelist that is just right there proclaiming we need to repent, you know, and those types of things. That's also a message of the gospel. But maybe you're just there doing good deeds and you say, you know what? I'm doing this because God loves me. And that influences people to want more. This is how Peter is saying, this is how we plant seeds and preach the gospel. So let me just give you an illustration here. So truth is truth. And this baseball bat might represent the reality of truth. And if this vase is not quite the shape that represent the values of the kingdom, there's one way that I can make that take on a different shape. I can use truth like a baseball bat. And I've played some baseball, so I can connect very seriously with this and conform this into a particular image that I prefer, because I don't prefer the current image. And that is one way that God uses in culture. Sometimes we need hard words. We need harshness sometimes with reality. Do you know that if you die today without Jesus, there's only one place you're going to go according to the Bible, and it's not going to be with God. And it's not going to be a happy place. You have to know that. Sometimes those are hard messages that feel like a baseball bat. And I don't know if anybody here has heard those messages and that was a particular influence that guided you in the right direction at some point. Sometimes we need the 2x4. Sometimes we need a hard thing, a hard word. But what Peter is saying here, that isn't the only tool in the toolbox. I'm not a mechanic. I have a crescent wrench. And the crescent wrench is a lot of things. But sometimes you need specialty tools. And so in addition to the baseball bat, which works in some occasions, what Peter is saying here in this culture is a really effective tool. Instead of a baseball bat of truth, we can use a seed of truth. Just one act, one word, one life that's just lived out, not so much with words as with a consistent, honorable behavior. And when enough of those seeds are planted in soil that Jesus says is good soil, what is produced, instead of conforming the external to what we would prefer it to look like, God does something internally and he brings about new life, transformation from the inside out. God works in all kinds of ways. What Peter is saying, that in some cases, the best thing to do is to live out your faith in a way that just brings honor to the name of Jesus. It doesn't have to be an overt slam over your head, I'm going to give you every part of the gospel, though I just met you 2 minutes ago. It can sometimes be a seed that God uses over time to produce transformation from the inside out. I'll put this here so we can look at that as for the rest of our time together. Living honorable lives and pointing people to Jesus. So another way we do that, the second thing that Peter tells us is that we treat others with honor. We honor God with our lives, we do good, but we also, how we interact with other people, how we treat people, even people that have different values and different beliefs, we treat them with honor. Now, he's going to zero in on institutions of authority, first of all. So we got to start there. He says, how are you going to honor these people? You be subject to them. You be subject to the emperor, Caesar in this case, which is Nero. We know who this is in real history. Nero was not a good guy. He was not really good to Christians in particular. He was one who burned Rome, you'll remember in history, about AD 68, and blamed it on the Christian, which, you know, if society in general was already suspicious about Christians, and Nero knew this, he was a manipulator. All he had to do was just throw a little gasoline and light a match. Yep, it was those Christians, the ones you never trusted all along, those slaves in your household, those people who you just, you know, had those different values. They're the ones who are destroying property. Get them. That's Nero. Now, this is before it got to that point when Peter's writing this letter. Maybe he would have written a little bit different strategy after that fact. But for now, the Holy Spirit of God in him is compelling him to say the best way to bring honor to the name of Jesus is to treat people with honor. And first, you start with those who are in authority. What basis does he give for this? Because Nero's not a good guy. He thinks of himself as God. He's not totally a fair person. He's pretty narcissistic. He's in it for himself. It's what's good for Nero is what's good for Rome is his, you know, his line of thinking. But he says this in verse 13. Let's read the passage here together. He says, "Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme," that's Nero, "or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you would put to silence the ignorance of foolish people." And so where we start with our society, make sure we are obeying or being subject to the institutions of authority that God has instituted. Why do I say this? Look what Paul says in Romans chapter 13, verse 6. Verse 1, he says, "Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God." So though we may disagree with the policies of a particular government, we honor them because we are honoring God as a result, because God is the one who put those authorities in place. And Peter helps us. We go back to our Peter passage, we see why. Verse 14, look at it. "Governors as sent by God to punish those who do evil and praise those who do good." It is the position of governors and those in authority to make sure that there's order in society. And they're going to praise people who do good, and they're going to punish those who do evil. Not every society adheres to those standards, obviously. There's a different view of what is good in different parts of the world. This is an oppressive government. This is a totalitarian government. You don't have a say, really. It's not a democracy. You don't vote for the emperor. And Peter is saying in the subject, they themselves are in a position of honoring those who do good and punishing those who do evil. They're going to answer to God however they did that. We answer to God by how we obeyed within the realms of our society the governing authorities that God has put in place. And so there, it's sometimes a conflict for us, and we hold a duality, and we hold those two realities in tension. I know the values of the kingdom of God. I know ultimately when I see God face to face, that's the values we're going to uphold with one another. And then there's the values of the society I live in, but here's where I'm living. I have to adhere to these laws while holding to these values as well. This is duality. Jesus taught on this very idea when they talked about, should we pay taxes to Caesar? And those taxes, by the way, were not fair. They were not just. And this is Jesus' reply. He says, "Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's and to God the things that are God's." Jesus is referring to this dualistic idea of, I know who my God is. I know who my king is. I know the values of my kingdom. And I also live on earth. I live in a society that I may not totally agree with, but God has instituted this for my good, whether I agree with it or not. And therefore, I have to try to juggle, how do I do both? And Jesus says, you use wisdom to know how to honor God and how to honor the institutions of authority now at the same time. Peter says this similarly in chapter 2, verse 16. He says, live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. So we know in our value system of God that we are all value, we are created equal. I shouldn't be oppressed as a human being. I should be valued just for who I am, made in God's image. But when I live in a society that doesn't believe that same thing, that I'm a lesser person because of my color of my skin or my gender or my political views or my personal views or my ability to contribute to whatever it is that marginalizes me, I know on the one hand I'm free and I don't have to fit into those categories. But on the other hand, I live in a culture that doesn't believe I'm free, that I need to fit into those categories. How do I do both? He says, live as free people, but not in a way that brings reproach to your name. How do you do that? You do that by serving God. It's like, God, you put these institutions in place. I'm going to do that to the best of my ability, as long as it doesn't conflict with the deep values of actual evil, like lying, cheating, murdering, stealing, reviling, meddling. He'll name these things later in the letter. And secondly, we give honor to everyone, not just authority structures. We give honor to everyone. Verse 17 says, honor everyone, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the emperor. Thankfully, we don't live under Emperor Nero. Thankfully, we do live in a culture that at least speaks that all mankind are equal, even though in practice we know that's not true. We treat each other differently based upon our biases. Thankfully, we have a lot of freedoms. We don't live under an oppressive government like Nero. We have votes, we have rights as citizens. We have a right to a fair trial. We have a right to speak and to put. We are a government not of the dictator, but of the people, right? We vote policies. We vote people into positions of power. And so how do we as people of God move in our culture? And I believe that what Peter would say is, you do everything you can within the laws of your land to proclaim my name and live as a person of honor. And that includes the very free right to vote, to petition. We have to peacefully assemble, to bring awareness, and so on. But we don't use those freedoms as a cover-up for evil. Like, I have free speech, and you can't get me down. I'm going to tell you exactly how I feel. And one of the churches in the United States, for instance, who do this, I wish they would read this passage over and over again, that they are protected to have these, they picket, you know the church I'm talking about, Westboro Baptist, who pickets when soldiers have been killed in Afghanistan. They'll picket their grave, their funerals, and they spread slander and hatred and slurs to segments of humanity that they don't like. And they're using their freedom. Their free speech is protected in the United States of America. They're using their freedom as a cover-up for evil, to spread hatred and slander and malign other human beings who are made in God's image. How does that make people equate this Baptist church with the message of God? Does that draw people to who God is, upholding the values of the kingdom, or does that push people away? We are to be people who are wise, who align ourselves to the values of the kingdom while honoring the laws of our land. And thankfully, we in the United States of America have lots of laws to protect our ability to speak and to vote and to put people in power that are going to promote the values that we hold. Let us do those things in a way that honor God, rather than use our speech to just belittle, malign, gossip, have slurs, banners that say, I'm going to overstep bounds here. Let's go, Brandon. That's clearly a slur against the President of the United States. I will go so far as to say that shouldn't be in a Christian home. Flag should not be held out in a Christian household. You can argue with me. I get it. There's so many ways that we can affect change for the kingdom of God and adorn the gospel of Jesus Christ. Remember, the goal is, I need people to be changed and transformed. And I don't know that the best way to do it is just to simply malign and be malicious and derogatory, to make other people look stupid. If that's our goal, I'm not sure how that adorns the gospel of Jesus Christ, to spread hatred toward people who hold values or live in a way that makes us uncomfortable, that I don't agree with. I want that person to know the truth, but I want them to know it through the name of Jesus and the kindness and love and patience that I myself have been shown by God himself as a follower of Jesus. How do we do that well? I'm not going to be totally black and white about that because it requires wisdom and the Spirit of God to compel us. But I see a lot of things done in the name of freedom. I'm not sure I would align with Jesus. Let us be wise in proclaiming who God is and living lives of honor and treating others with the honor that God has shown us. Let's stand together as we finish our service. Jonathan and the worship team coming to lead us in our final song.
Grateful for this group of people. You have called us to be a light in our community. I see the power of your Spirit and the love that is displayed in Jesus in this community through these people. God, help us to proclaim your name and make it great in the various ways you've called us to live as people of honor and to do good in this community. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Grace and peace to you today. Happy Mother's Day.